to North Star Oasis. I'm your host, Jeff Williams, with another jam-packed episode today. We happen to be right in the midsummer months. Let's enjoy the weather while it lasts. As we've had in previous discussions, we've always kind of hinted around at what the staff should be getting for Christmas. You know, there is only 124 shopping days left until Christmas. And to my producer, Dallas, if you can put my computer up on the screen. And we're going to play a quick video here. This is a very short one because I think I have figured out what my producer wants. This is from the Rifleman series with Chuck Connors. And I think for Christmas I am going to get my producer a DVD box set. Especially since today he was talking about how he just really loved the series The Rifleman and was looking for one particular episode that he just wished he could have DVR'd. So I think maybe I might just have to, you know, supply him with the complete series just as a gracious Christmas present. But I got 124 days to chew on that. But those are the days of television. Now we're going to move on to one other thing before we get into our actual regular feature, and that is something that happened with the Donald, who we featured on this show last week. Donald Trump made a comment about Heidi Klum. In an interview with Maureen Dowd that took more than a few twists and turns, Trump commented, "Heidi Klum, sadly, she's no longer a 10. What are you on, Donald? Here is Heidi Klum's response. If I can find it here, because I'm scrolling through her Twitter account right now. And Trump has spoken. There it is. This is a video that she put together. All right, well, she just Trump because if she's not a 10, well, there's 999 is, I think, good enough for the rest of us. And speaking of presidential politics, our presidential flavor of the week. And if you have not been a regular viewer, okay, question Trump's judgment from my producer. If you have been a regular viewer of our show, you'll know that we do the presidential flavor of the week. We have so many presidential candidates, we have just been giving you a segment. Our first segment, every single show, has to deal with a different presidential candidate each week. Last week we had Donald Trump, and we're on YouTube, so go to youtube.com/NorthStarOasis, and you can watch our segment on Donald Trump from last week. But we have a new candidate for this week. And so here we go, from the state of Louisiana. Governor Bobby Jindal. Watch this.
My name is Bobby Jindal. I am governor of the great state of Louisiana, and I am running for president of the greatest country in the world, the United States of America. I know that some believe I talk about my faith too much, but I will not be silenced. They don't seem to accept the idea that you can be both intellectual and Christian. They can't fathom the notion that you can be both smart and conservative. They need to get out more. There's a big country out here with millions of Americans who believe in God and are not ashamed to say so. If we try to hide who we are again, we will lose again. You've heard Jeb Bush say that we need to be willing to lose the primary in order to win the general election. We're going to help him do that. Let me translate that for you. I want to translate that political speak into plain English. What Jeb Bush is saying is that we need to hide our conservative ideals. But the truth is, if we go down that road again, we will lose again. I am asking you to believe again. Believe in what we can do. Believe in what America can do. Thank you. May God bless you. May God bless the United States of America.
We were made to be courageous. We were made.
And that was the announcement from Bobby Jindal, the governor of Louisiana. And we're going to take a closer look as to Jindal a little bit more on his background and his announcement.
Louisiana Governor Bobby Jindal announced he is officially running for president in 2016. The announcement came in the form of videos like this one of him and his wife telling his children he is running.
Okay, if we move into the White House, you can have a party.
Yay!
Jindal at one time was considered an upcoming star in the GOP. In a party looking for diversity, his parents are immigrants from India, although Jindal rejects the term Indian American and has called for the end of hyphenated Americans. He was Assistant Secretary of Health and Human Services under George W. Bush. He was also elected to Congress in 2005 and served until 2008, when he then became the governor of Louisiana. But lately, Jindal's popularity has been dwindling. He has been polling dead last among 2016 Republican hopefuls, and his approval ratings are even slipping in his home state.
We don't just need a Republican in the White House. We need a Republican who's going to make big changes.
Still, he has been acting like a candidate for a while now. He has already been traveling to early primary states and giving interviews. Now, Jindal has his work cut out for him. He enters a field of more than 10 major GOP presidential candidates. For Newsy, I'm Kate Grumke.
Yes, Governor Jindal has his work cut out for him, and he is trailing in the polls. The most recent Rasmussen poll came out, and that shows that he's polling at 1% amongst the likely voters in the GOP presidential nomination. Fox News has him rated at 1%. And then the CNN ORC poll has him at 0. And his Real Clear Politics average is 0.7%. But the thing is, when you get a chance to see Bobby Jindal, when you get a chance to hear Bobby Jindal, he's got a lot of upside. He's got a tremendous amount of upside. And when you look at what he's done in the state of Louisiana, it hasn't been bad, especially considering he took over in post-Katrina Louisiana. And as a result, I think that the more people know about Bobby Jindal, the more you're going to start seeing him rise. I mean, there's tremendous upside here. The one thing that I have to mention that really, I have to say, impressed me, considering that we had just run the first of those Planned Parenthood videos on this show a couple of weeks ago. I guess this last Thursday, I had heard that Planned Parenthood supporters were planning a major protest outside of the governor's mansion. I'm still a little not sure of the details. But he was... There was this protest in support of Planned Parenthood. And what Jindal said is, okay, they're going to protest. Well, I don't think they've seen the videos yet. So he had big television screens put up in the protest area. And he says, they got a right to protest there. But at the same time, we've got a right to show them the videos. And had run all 6 or 7 of the Planned Parenthood videos. Now, that's what the plan was for Thursday. I haven't heard a follow-up as to whether or not that happened. But I'll tell you this, to do something like that really takes a lot of courage. And Bobby Jindal has done just that. And so I have to say kudos to Jindal for that bold move. Now, let's take a look at what Bobby Jindal has to say in a town hall meeting going against Hillary Clinton.
I've got a question for all of you here today. How many of you have either currently or previously served in our military, in any branch of the military? Let's give these men and women a great round of applause. I want to thank you for your service, but I want to ask you this question. When you were serving, if your recklessness, if you had been this reckless with classified information, with the nation's secrets, what would have happened to you? You think you would have gotten a promotion? Think you would have said, what difference does it make? Well, no, and here Hillary Clinton wants to be our commander-in-chief. I don't know about you, but I think the general and the private should follow the same rules and the same laws. is good enough to find it.
He makes a very, very valid point with that, and it's a point that I've made the entire time that this issue has been brought up. I served in the United States Air Force for almost 17 years. We have been given repeated briefings from the time you first get in until the time you get out about operational security, OPSEC and COMSEC, communication security. Do not send classified information via email. That was repeatedly pounded through our heads. The penalty for doing so is severe. You know what? David Petraeus, former general, he got in severe trouble. And what he did was far less. So this whole thing that Hillary Clinton comes out and makes excuses left and right, I don't buy. Because if I would have been in and done the same thing while I was in the military, and would have had severe consequences, then the Secretary of State should have had the same type of consequences. And that's a big reason why I'm not supporting Hillary Clinton, because what's good for the goose is good for the gander. And if my goose would have been cooked, I think hers should have been cooked too. So it's really good to see Bobby Jindal speaking up about this in a way that makes sense. And that's why I think that Jindal is one of the candidates to watch. As I mentioned, he's got a tremendous upside. And it's going to be, as we get into these debates coming up, it's going to be fun to watch. In the meantime, last week we had highlighted where I was last week, and that was at Fort Snelling for Civil War weekend. And so we have a video that we're going to show you on what those activities were. Okay, we have technical difficulties here. So I'm waiting for the control booth to tell me what's going on. And I'm still waiting word.
We're not getting any video signal from your computer.
Not getting any video signal from my computer. That might be why. Let's try this again. It appears that on my computer, one of my cords may have been bumped out. So here we go. Much better.
Marching, eating, taking whatever you can. Very
just,
good.
Just
the Army tells us to do.
That's as it should be, your soldier. And you'll be mustered out shortly here then, and that's it?
Yep.
Back to the farm, perhaps?
Yep. One for office.
Welcome home. One for... Oh, good man.
Yeah.
Well done. Welcome home.
Step right up
boys over there. How's that walk up the hill there, gentlemen?
Great.
Coffee?
Yes.
Yeah, cooking going.
Excellent.
Yeah, well, it's hot.
Yeah.
Pink juice, sir. Vitamins and minerals. And there's coffee as well. Plenty of bread and pickles.
Two, sir.
Oh, yeah, the crowd's got stretched. How's the crowd last?
This is all the crowd. Pink juice?
That's better to say, yeah, you
know. And then there's coffee over there.
Yeah.
It might have been 3 minutes.
Yeah.
We're in the car.
Heat up. And of course, if you find a horseshoe, it's a lucky horseshoe. Compared to the horse who lost it, who's an unlucky horse. Nice piece of charcoal there. Let's grab that nail out once more. There you go, folks. Should we chop it off now? Let's chop it off with this tool here, the hardy. Chop it off right there. We'll leave extra metal there for the nail head. If I chop all four sides, I always get a better nail head that way. I just discovered that recently. Better nail that way. Stop there and bend it down. Our nail is almost complete. Zeb, we're going to heat it one more time to finish the nail. Nails like that, yes. Well, we're working with a fire that's running at about 3,000 degrees Fahrenheit in the middle. That heats up the iron pretty fast. It is hot enough we can weld steel and iron in the fire. But today I'm just forging things. Take this tool, the nail header. See the hole through the end? That'll hold the point. Just grab it out. Let's drop in the nail header tool there, break it off. And now let's strike while the iron is hot, huh? Break it off right there. There we go. Let's beat it down flat and make a nail head. Here we go. You like that? Should we drop in the water tank for a moment and hear it hiss? Here we go. Now we're cool. Shall we try out that nail and test it to make sure it works? Watch this, folks. You know, nails are simple enough things. They either work or they don't.
There you go. And the gun is successfully fired. Thank you for bearing with us. Once the final cannon has been cleared, feel free to come up, take a look at these. The 12-pounder Napoleon is an original from the Civil War. It's 151 years old. So feel free, once the guns are cleared, to come up, ask questions, and take a look. Thank you very much.
How do people handle that? Oh, thank you, guys. I do have to write those letters. Yes. I definitely have to tell them how much I'm enjoying this walk.
Close ranks, they had opened up into two ranks, so now they're going to bring themselves back into that nice, tight formation, standing shoulder to shoulder, and about as firm as
between them. Shoulder!
Their commands such as wheels, flanks, smile, and all ways to move that company, that that battalion, that regiment around each other, to bring them across that battlefield, to bring them to bear on that target. You see how they're now maneuvering here. They're moving from that battalion front or that long line of two soldiers into another formation.
Well, this is what
imagine you're moving down a road.
Shoulder strap. I'm just going to sign it this way because we can do whatever we want, right?
You can.
And then I'll let my wife write something intelligent.
Who would you like me to write it to? Oh, yeah,
these are
the
boys'
names. All right. I cannot be called upon to write anything. Oh, intelligent.
How do you pronounce them?
It's pronounced
by
Mielin
Van Suren.
Okay.
Those are.
Oh. Oh. How should we write this one? You want it for you specifically?
Yeah.
You sure?
Yeah.
Of course. Like, I'm gonna have my. I'm gonna draw a picture.
Okay.
Let me think about it. Let me give this some thought. So.
There's so much.
Like a
look forward to the next book.
Right. All right. Thank you.
Each company.
Very, very
yeah,
good.
That was very. Good.
You and you have the core band.
A good day today.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good. Well, thanks for visiting us. Come back again and read up on the Civil War, okay?
Sounds good.
And that was Fort Snelling Civil War weekend. That was last Saturday. It was also last Saturday and Sunday. Those are just random scenes that we had shot on Saturday. And the Minnesota Civil War 150 Facebook page is still active. So that's Minnesota Civil War 150 on Facebook. If you want more information on what the Civil War Task Force is doing for the rest of the year. I do have to also say a special thank you to Dave Geister. He is the long white-haired gentleman that you saw in the video. It just seems that wherever I'd go, he'd be there and vice versa. And so he ended up serving as an excellent moderator for this segment. So thanks, Dave. Appreciate it. Well, one of the reasons why I wanted to show that first is because of something else that was happening last weekend. And that happened right here in our own community in North St. Paul. They dedicated the brand new Veterans Memorial Park. And while one of us was over in Fort Snelling, we had another crew member over at North St. Paul. And here are some of the scenes that were shown. We're going to start off with the invocation, and then we'll have some other speeches, you know, excerpts of speeches and all from there. That's section one. Okay, well, what have you got? Leon first. Then put Leon first. Okay, well, I guess we're going to go right over to State Representative Leon Lilly.
Ours wasn't at the top of the list, to be honest. There was this city, I don't know, I'm a hockey guy, so I'm going to name, you guys can figure it out, but they were cake eaters, and over in the West Metro, and they were going to get about $100,000 because, you know, let's be honest, it was a political year. Dan kept looking at me, and the team came down with the mayor and the city, and made a presentation. And they did such an amazing job. The chair, Alice Hausman, and the rest of the House members were like just struck by the force of this group and the presentation. I mean, look at this. This is unbelievable. It's even better than that fancy brochure, of course, but it's amazing. So, and actually, the questions weren't about this project. The other members on the committee were like, how'd you do it? What are you doing? So they wanted to bring this idea back to their community and kind of steal it and go with it. But hats off to your committee, and it's what a treasure, and I'm just happy to do my small part with Senator Wieger.
And that was our state representative in the North St. Paul area, Leon Lilly. Now we're going to hear a brief bit from State Senator Chuck Wieger.
Reading more into history, I knew that this whole community has always practiced what it talks about. Henry Castle, you see a picture of him here, the founder. He was Captain Henry Castle. He served in the Civil War. And just one brief thing about history. Imagine it was 20 degrees right now. That might be kind of nice. That would be 98 years ago. And this is true. I just read about it in North St. Paul's history book. Most of the community gathered. There was a banquet, and they were sending off to war 14 teenagers, young men, off to war. 1918, right before the end of the war. And they had a parade coming right down Margaret Street. Now, Don Regan, you weren't there, were you? No, okay, no, excuse me. Okay, anyway, they're marching down. And some of you might remember, there was a train station out here. Anyone remember that? And they had the train waiting. They sang, it was a Mr. Zwicky, did the Star Spangled Banner. The Lugers gave them a little extra greenbacks, as they call them, to spend. There was a lot of gifts and a lot of tears. And this community, most of it, they were all right out here about 100 years ago. Just as many of our communities here today. So our roots are so deep, and the pride.
And that was State Senator Chuck Wieger in North St. Paul. And it seems that we did find our clip of the invocation, so we are going to show that right now.
We pray as well for those who have been injured on the battlefield and must fight daily the battles that, as they bear firsthand the wounds of war. And in remembering the sacrifice of all who have served, Lord, we ask that you help each of us to be inspired to greater sacrifice of ourselves in ways that can benefit others and our nation and the cause of peace in our world. Lord, you are Lord of your kingdom of love and peace and justice. We pray that you bless this memorial and that it may be for years to come a sign of remembrance of all those courageous men and women who have fought for our nation, and a sign of the call that you give to us to move forward in your grace and your hope, building your kingdom where you live and reign forever and ever.
I'm going to stop right here as far as showing the clips. We've got just a couple of more to show you here. You know, the first thing I want to show, just mention, is how the invocation actually talked about the people who were doing the fighting. That's the one thing about a Veterans Memorial. I just shown you the Fort Snelling Civil War weekend, which is actually just kind of a tribute and a way of educating people as to what Civil War soldiers underwent. But you can get that with all eras. But the priest who gave the invocation is the only one so far who had mentioned veterans. Take a look at Leon Lilly's speech. Leon Lilly was talking about his legislative accomplishments and how he could secure taxpayer funding for the North St. Paul Veterans Memorial. I'll tell you this, when Washington County put their Veterans Memorial up in, I think, 1918, October, 100 years ago, they had their Veterans Memorial. And you know what? It was the veterans themselves who pitched in and raised the funds. They didn't need to go to the legislature and say, hey, we need to hijack taxpayer funding. Now, don't get me wrong, I am glad to, you know, see the fact that they showed up. I am glad to see the fact that they have the memorial. But Leon Lilly just simply taking credit for securing $10,000 in funding and then complaining because they didn't get $100,000, I can definitely tell he's a civilian and never served a day in his life. Chuck Weger, I have to at least give a little bit of credence to in the fact that he told a story about veterans from 100 years ago. And so hats off in my book. I know that Chuck didn't serve in the military, but the thing is, at least he was able to put a historical face on that. And that should be commended. And then we have Congresswoman Betty McCollum.
Because as our Park Service celebrates its 100th centennial, we can go out, click on this park, and say, find this park, and people from all over across the United States and the world will know what this community and these volunteers did today. So go out to the website, National Park, find this park, mark it.
Find this park, mark it. Make sure everybody in this country knows that the little tiny town of North St. Paul has a Veterans Memorial. Okay, not bad. But for somebody who serves on the U.S. House of Representatives Committee on the Interior, you can go ahead and find this park on a map, but you cannot fly a Confederate battle flag in a Civil War National Park, at least according to our Congresswoman Betty McCollum. So I'm getting mixed messages here. But the political speech is notwithstanding, and I have to say that Mayor Mike Keene and Councilmember Terry Furlong also were there, and we do have the entire program on the YouTube channel, youtube.com/NorthStarOasis, so you can go ahead and watch the entire ceremony without my editorial comments, and you know, at least try to enjoy that moment. But now here is the big moment of the unveiling. So that was the unveiling. That's what the new Veterans Memorial Park. Once again, we have a state of Minnesota on granite with a veteran in it. But I think it looks pretty cool, and I'm really glad to see that the VFW and the Legion and others had stepped up, the politicians notwithstanding. And then we also have the roll call of the fallen.
Just to clarify, this is not a memorial park. This is a veterans park that contains a memorial. On the granite panels below the flags in front, in your front, there are a list of killed in action and POW MIA names from every conflict from World War I to the present. There is a saying you may have heard that freedom is not free. This list of North St. Paulites are people who in their respective conflicts have given their full measure so that freedom can continue to ring. With the assistance of Joe Zakreski, we will recognize their sacrifice. From World War I, Mary Cummings. Leroy Flint. Arthur O. Hawklin. Emil Newman. Rudolph Shockey. Frank Stepnitz. Otto Troutman. Harold Dean. Earl Peters. And Owen Pearson. From World War II, Martin Thiel Jr. Walter H. Young. William F. Carth. Eldon Keane. Richard E. Newman. Richard K. Notebart. Cletus J. Gumbold. Robert Cassidy. And Myron M. Zamansky. From Korea, Roger H. Ale. William C. Bendorf. Ernest C. Dopner. From Vietnam, Stephen R. Bauer. James T. Pro. Douglas C. Merrill. Kale A. Solberg. Eugene D. Spicer. James F. Malloy. Bernard T. Hansen. And Roger W. Swanson, MIA. From Iraq, Gregory F. Rundell. And from Afghanistan, Matthew J. Johnson. And Chad D. Froker. Ladies and gentlemen, please remain standing and remove your headgear for the rendering of honors to the fallen by the North St. Paul Veterans of Foreign Wars, Post 1350 Rifle Squad, and Fort Snelling Bugler Tom Mullen. Rifle Squad Captain, render appropriate honors to the fallen.
And yes, we did take the out of sequence, whereas in the actual event, that roll call of the names occurred before the unveiling. But I just felt that let's see the memorial and then let's hear the names. And then it all wrapped up with a short benediction.
God grant the living grace and to the departed rest. This nation born... Those born on this soil and those who come here from all corners of the earth is on a continual journey toward its destiny. May we never let down those who have served in defense of this country. May we uphold the values of freedom, of the inherent dignity of every human being by our own right conduct, by the kindness and the tolerance we show to one another. May we lead the world by example, and become, in the words of the prophet Isaiah, a light to the nations. Then will the labors and sacrifices of these veterans be honored not in words alone, but by our deeds. May the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit come down upon you and remain with you always. Amen.
That was the dedication of the North St. Paul Veterans Memorial. And so I want to just encourage you to take some time out of your day sometime this week and just swing by and pay it a visit. And before I move on to our next section, I do want to make note that I did have a question that came in regarding the plaque that we had shown at the entrance to Fort Snelling about the internments. And, you know, we only used like 5 seconds of that. So I wanted to just point out the fact that there were approximately 1,600 Dakota Indians who were interred during the U.S.-Dakota War at Fort Snelling. And that's what that had actually gone on to denote. So thank you to the person who asked that question. And then right now, while we take a look at what we have left on time, we are going to show you some footage that we had shot at La Familia.
School policies and school programming. I'm really concerned about the implementation of the behavior management program in your schools. I mean, and that's the only thing I can say, because properly implemented, a good system like PBIS, you would have administrative and teacher and support staff aligned regarding the building of positive and safe and inclusive school culture. And then when incidences happened, there's legislation in place to address it. So the teachers and the administrators should all be trained in the anti-bullying legislation. And again, I'm not immediately in your situation, and I'm deeply empathizing, but my first thought is, as somebody who works on at a systems level, is what is your behavior implementation system, and how trained are your people?
It's not existent with my kids.
Okay.
Have you talked to the school board at all?
This is the very first time I was able to bring it up.
To anybody. As part of, we have been a very large debate about bullying and how to manage that. And the question I have is, if school boards, and I came from a school board, they are empowered to implement programs in the school. And part of it is to make sure kids are safe and to make sure kids have the support that they need to be successful. My first question to you would be, what is that school board doing about the very issue you're bringing up? If they're taking the position that we can't do anything about it, then that's a problem that we need to address at the state level, but I think that would be breaking the law. Because we do have a law that says that you have to have these policies in place and you have to implement them. And if the school board isn't doing it, maybe there needs to be an election to elect different school board members, or maybe there needs to be a shakeup in the administration. I don't know, but I think the question about implementation of policy at the local level has to go to that local board.
You have to
hold them accountable.
Thank you very much.
There's a common conversation that people have about Latinos when they're going to immigration for. And this is a statement. They do the work nobody wants to do. It's repeated over and over again by so many people that are for immigration reform or want it done, and they'll say, well, these Latinos will do the work no one wants them to do. And I was, again, on CC Radio, I said, well, let me make a statement about that. Yes, we'll do the work, but that's not our destiny. Our destiny is the American dream. Our destiny is being successful. Our destiny is going to be to learn, to be educated, and to be leaders in this country. So don't expect Latinos to be doing all those jobs. We're looking for another group. But, if this achievement gap persists, if it persists, that could be the destiny. That's our issue. Thank you. This is a great day here. We're hoping to do something again, but I want to thank you. If you get a chance, stop in at the La Familia Hall. I really appreciate it. Thank you. Came to the conclusion that if we don't do something about it as a community, this thing's not going anywhere. Only 45% of the kids are graduating high school. Yeah, Minnesota. So there's some things to do. But here's Henry Capiz. Now, if you know the Capiz family, they were one of the first original families here in Minnesota. And in fact, they lived right on this very street here. It used to be Concord, now it's Cesar Chavez. And what a wonderful contribution this family's made. But I think Henry was a unique individual that served this country, rose to the rank, a lieutenant in the Air Force Guard, and in his capacity as a professional career, was head pharmacist at the United Hospital. So this is a gentleman that has indeed made his mark here in the community, but it's a very appropriate conversation. I want you to listen carefully. Henry Capiz was the son of migrant workers. He worked on the farm on his knees, like the older ones like myself. I'm in my 80s. And we can tell you stories because we're living history. You want to know something, the truth, talk to Henry, talk to seniors. Henry's parents got married in Albert Lee. Henry got drafted out of high school. Now you picture an 18-year-old person here and figure that's when Henry got taken out of school. He didn't volunteer, he was drafted. He didn't finish high school. He went into the military and he qualified for the airborne and joined the airborne. He served in the Pacific on the islands during World War II. He came back and he decided he should go to school. Yeah, and both with the Hispanic marketing conferences, and, you know, those awards mean something. They really do. It's not a small thing. It's at least something we can do to show that we really appreciate these efforts. And these efforts are real. You know, going to meetings and having to take your time away when you could be doing things with your family, it's very real. It sounds cliche, but it's not, because these are tough times for business owners and for a lot of individuals. But in keeping that in mind, it's all about sacrifice. And it's also about having lived through some incident, or having lived through some family personal problems and health issues that sometimes motivate people to get involved and to take a risk. And that's our next award recipient, Ida Pinero, because, you know, Ida had was with U.S. Bank, and I believe that her father had a heart disease, I believe, and Ida suffered through that, and I've known this young lady for a long time, and she's a terrific lady. But I could feel the pain and the fact that, you know, we were back to Puerto Rico but one of the things that happens to the people that are personal leaders is that they do something about it. They want to give back, and that was the story of how she became involved with the Heart Association and became one of the first Latinas in corporate America that is one of the top fundraisers for the Heart Association. But let me tell you about that. Because when she took on that effort for U.S. Bank, you have to prove yourself. This isn't something about, well, I'm going to do it and then, you know, have a few people. No, she went head on into this, and due to the fact that we love this lady, And the cause is real, and her passion, we could feel, is real. She has taken this event to one of the top events in the Twin Cities, one of the top fundraising events in the Twin Cities.
We have veterans here. My dad was a veteran, and so I grew up with all of that, so I have a lot of understanding. And with the American Heart Association, I mean, this is something that I never share my personal story, but my dad had heart problems. He had a stroke and was in a wheelchair for 11 years. So sometimes we take a lot of things for granted and we don't learn how to appreciate, you know, life. And that's my biggest motivation. Just to keep educating and bringing not only the Hispanics, but everyone together. And one of the biggest impacts, you know, we want to thank, have a lot of volunteers here, Frederick, Esther, Rachel, Peter, Ulysses, Miguel Ramos, that they have been involved, but this week, especially this week, I found out that one of my high school friends that I grew up with, and she's a pharmacist, and her dad is a doctor, I mean, it doesn't matter. She, at the age of 35, she had a stroke, and she is in the hospital battling with her life. And it's, I mean, in those news, they're shocking news that you like, what? So sometimes when I think that I'm gonna back up, I'm not gonna do anything about it, we have to come together and do something positive about it. And that's basically all of you. And we not only we have hard.
And one word about Henry Capiz. He actually lives in Maplewood. And he was born February 18th, 1926. So he's almost 90. So it's really great to see that they were able to honor him during La Familia. And in the last couple of moments that we have here together, I wanted to mention something that was newsworthy in the world of economics this week. And that happens to be Mr. George Soros. As many people know, George Soros is a major hedge fund manager, and he had been a big supporter of President Obama during his campaign season, and I believe that George Soros was the spearhead behind President Obama's war on coal. The coal prices, some of the coal stocks have gone from like $135 per share down to $1. Six coal companies have been pushed out of business. But what did George Soros invest in last week? Arch Coal and Peabody Energy, two of the largest coal companies in America. So what does this tell me? This tells me that Soros is ready to make a profit. He probably ended up shorting the stock on the way down. And that he probably does not have faith that a Democrat will be elected president next year, because I think his investing strategies would be different. Now, he only threw in, I think, $2 million investments, so that's not really a whole lot compared to what his net worth is. But if you take a look at what George Soros' history has been, you know, his history has been, shorting the British pound is how he made a lot of money. I'm sure he made a lot of money as it righted, as it came back up. He has done that to other commodities as well. And, you know, I think Soros always believed that a coal-less energy policy doesn't work. I think he played the environmentalist movement like a fiddle. That if you get them to be punitive and you get them to shut down coal, then what you end up getting is cheap coal, and the coal prices will go down. He makes money on the short sales. Now we're seeing a covering, and now he's going to make money as things get righted. So just something to keep an eye on, especially if you hear more punitive news about fracking. You heard it here first that that's probably the next thing, is fracking is going to be back in the news in a not so positive light. But anyhow, we're out of time. So please join us at youtube.com/NorthStarOasis. Join us at Facebook, facebook.com/NorthStarOasis. And from the studios of Suburban Community Channels, I'm Jeff Williams. We'll see you next week.